So a few things before we get into this. I just want to announce that you should follow me on Odyssey because I will be posting a lot of content a day or two earlier on Odyssey. I also will be posting Odyssey exclusive content that I don't think would be very good for YouTube's algorithm. So we're going to be kind of focusing more of my attention over at Odyssey. Also, this will be the last YouTube video that I will upload on this channel because reasons. As you can tell by the name of this channel, it is now called the Jim Jesus Archive. If you want to follow my new YouTube channel, if you insist on staying on YouTube, go ahead. I will post a link in the description to my new YouTube channel, which you can follow there. Also, there's going to be a lot less looking at the camera on this one because there is a lot of factual information that I need to get into, and I need to make sure that all of my ducks are in a row because I think that this topic is very important, and I think a lot of libertarians need to understand the points that I'm making in this video, and I want to make sure that I have all of my factual information right. So I'm going to be focusing a lot of my attention on a script that I have pre-prepared. So sorry if I'm not staring into your big, beautiful eyes. Now, with all of that out of the way, I want to talk a little bit about agorism and its relationship to the USSR. But before we do that, I think that it might be appropriate to don the appropriate garb. Now, a common thing that I hear from libertarians on Twitter is that, did you know that the Soviet Union fell because of agorism? Or actually, most of them are saying, in part, because of agorism. Now, the statement is wrong on many different levels, not the least of which is that agorism isn't just selling weed and bread illegally. No. It is an ideology that says that counter-economics is not only the most libertarian strategy, it is the one that will end the state with the most efficacy. Now, I did a whole video and I did a whole breakdown about my problems with agorism, and I will post that in the link in the description below as well. You can go and check that out there. This might help you understand a lot of the problems that I'm going to be having with this kind of line of questioning, but it is not necessary. Now, a more charitable version of that argument, I think what they're really trying to say is that counter-economics is what helped lead to the eventual collapse of the Soviet Union, and therefore, agorism is a good ideology. I think that's what they're really trying to say. Now, this runs afoul with a lot of the understanding of what happened during the fall of the Soviet Union, so much so that I would argue that the opposite is true, is that agorism is a very small factor of why the Soviet Union lasted for as long as it did, rather than imploding sooner and killing even more people, right? We'll get into that later, but for now, let's just kind of leave that on the table. Now, the Union of Soviet Republic, which lasted from 1921 to 1991, was a Marxist-Leninist socialist transitional state with one of the most grossest human rights records in the world in the 20th century, and some of the worst poverty amongst its so-called first world nations, and a perpetrator of large-scale imperialist policies and responsible for a genocide known as the Holodomor. However, it wouldn't be the only way the USSR would punish people in the Ukraine, as we will hear about later. But one of the reasons why they did this is they thought that nationalizing all industries, illegalizing profit, and having the state control all facets of the economy would lead to full communism, a stateless, classless, moneyless, egalitarian society where the workers own the means of production. However, like all previous attempts and current attempts, this usually results in what's known by economists as a dismal failure. But we're not going to shit on communism for this video, because that's not what this video is about. We're here to talk about why the Soviet Union failed and test that against a silly Lulbert talking point. So what did bring down the Soviet Union? Well, to summarize, a nuclear bomb and a cover-up, an internal and external pressures to liberalize, the liberalization, and the cherries on top, the Soviet-Afghanistan war, and a coup d'etat. In April 26, 1986, at 1:23 a.m. Moscow time, an explosion occurred at the reactor 4 of what's commonly known as the Chernobyl nuclear power plant. However, it is more aptly named and officially named the Vladimir Lenin nuclear power plant because it was a piece of shit. This explosion was caused during a safety test that led to the reactor core to explode, sending radioactive materials not just in the city of Pripyat, Chernobyl, Ukraine, but as far as Sweden and the United Kingdom, as they were even seeing spikes of radioactive activity at the time. Long story short, the reason why the core exploded, which was thought to be an impossible thing for RBMK reactors, so they thought, was because the Soviet Union thought it would be better to build a reactor on the cheap rather than to have it be more efficient and, well, safe. Now, the operators could be partially blamed. However, a lot of those cost-saving measures were classified as state secrets and were only known to those operators. Cost-saving measures that caused the reactor to be as unstable as it was. Had they known, this probably could have been prevented. And the Soviets were also putting pressures on those operators to do well or face, you know, gulag time, prison time, death. Now, a lot of people consider the Chernobyl disaster to be the true end of the Soviet Union, including General Secretary of the USSR, Mikhail Gorbachev himself. It was when people had lost faith in the Soviet fantasy land that was constructed for them, it completely undermined the legitimacy of the state in their eyes. It also didn't help that the official death toll of the disaster by the USSR was 31 people, where even the most conservative estimates put it at least 4,000, and those numbers are considered extremely low to most historians. By the way, I really recommend you guys check out the show on HBO Max or on the public library called Chernobyl. It's a great TV show, and if you really want to get a better understanding of what happened during the Chernobyl disaster, it is a great and factual account of what happened there. Post-World War II, the Soviet Empire and the United States relationship fell into a kind of turmoil, and that led to a decades-long Cold War, where the U.S. and the Soviets were hostile to each other without ever firing a single shot. Allegedly. The U.S. has maintained pressure on not only the Soviet Union, but a lot of the communist states that were friendly to the USSR, including Chile, Cuba, Vietnam, China, and the DPRK. You had a lot of pressure that led to the Soviet Union to enter an arms race against the United States, diverting lots of resources that it could have been used elsewhere in the economy to not only build an arsenal of nuclear weapons, but to build a space race as well. The U.S. was also funding efforts with the Mujahideen in the Soviet-Afghanistan War. You also had Reagan and Bush 1 administrations also in talks with Mikhail Gorbachev in attempting to encourage him to liberalize, which, by the way, he was a reformer. So those talks were very effective. Meanwhile, internally, the Communist Party of the Soviet Union and their perestroika movement pushing the General Council to liberalize and be more transparent and democratic. In fact, the pressure was one of the reasons why Mikhail Gorbachev was even elected to be the General Council in the first place. The Soviet Union had also opened up democratic systems that allowed people to vote. Sure, they could only vote for other Communist Party members, but allowed them to elect ones that were far less, a totalitarian. And after the Chernobyl disaster, it got to be too much, and the Soviet Union started to cave to these pressures, and Mikhail Gorbachev introduced a series of reforms. The Law of Cooperatives, which was enacted in 1988, which allowed the worker co-ops to operate. Sure, this was not exactly the most free market libertarian version, but we can all agree that at least this is a step in the right direction. And then you had Glasnost, which the Soviet Union wanted to become more transparent and to try to restore faith in the Soviet system. But because of the dishonest nature of the USSR, the transparency only got people to be more skeptical of the USSR because they were just more honest about having just completely lied to them over the years. It also allowed less restrictions on political speech and the press, which only made things far more worse for the Soviet state. And to add fuel to the fire, a lot of these people saw these reforms as not the state trying to improve, but rather that the state was in a free fall decline. And it was. And after the fall of the Berlin Wall and the coup d'etat, any semblance of a stable state in the eyes of the Soviet people were completely shattered. Gorbachev finally caved on Christmas Day, 1991, and resolved to dissolve the Soviet Union once and for all. The next day, the Soviet Union was no more. Sure, there was a lot of economic pressures pushing the USSR into collapse, but that wasn't exacerbated by black and gray market activities. In fact, they actually kind of legalized a lot of those kind of activities to allow people to get access to food. Now, let's say that it did instead. You want to compare that to factors like an arms race, a space race, and conflicts in the Middle East. These were monumental projects with major impacts on the economy versus some, you know, illegal bread kitchens and meat markets of ill repute. I don't think so. To say that black markets affected the economic problems of the Soviet state to warrant a collapse is more akin to saying that a breeze from an air conditioner in a basketball stadium helped the ball fly into the basket because it was blowing in the same general direction the ball was heading. It had nothing to do with the guy who shot the ball or his athletic abilities or the amounts of practice he went under to make that shot. It is absolutely ridiculous, and you're basically making the same argument. Now, earlier I had said that black and gray markets prolonged the Soviet state rather than help it collapse. It's really simple to understand that once you understand the true nature of the collapse of the Soviet Union. If there were no black and gray markets, it would be harder for people to survive communism. If the Soviet state were to wipe out an entire population because of its gross management of resources, it would have failed earlier, but at the cost of 100 million people or more. So, sure, communism lasted longer, but the death toll was substantially limited by the people who were able to help alleviate their suffering and death through the illegal sale of essential goods. Now, if there were no black and gray markets, it would have been harder to survive communism. And if the Soviet state were to wipe out its entire population, it would have failed even sooner. But that would have costed far more lives. So sure, communism lasted longer, but the death toll was substantially limited by the people who were allowed to alleviate their suffering and death through the illegal sale of essential goods. This is why even today, even the harshest totalitarian communist regimes that are still out there, the couple that are left, have official policies on how to deal with black markets that allow people to get food. Because if too many of your people die, you can't get away with so much. And you can't get away with it on the world stage either. So let me know what you think. Am I wrong about this? Am I more right about this? Because I missed some other evidence that shows that I'm even more right. Let me know in the comment description below. And if you guys support me on Locals, you probably would have heard me made a lot of these arguments far earlier while I was driving in my car on the way home with information that I knew off the cuff. Which is what everybody wants to hear, is another rambly video of a guy driving around in his car. I think someone actually started their career that way. Can't remember who. Anyways, I will talk to you guys later. Worms.